for a moment. Continuing his train of thought, Tracy said to himself, "Ah, but if he should cable me to come home, I couldn't do that. I mustn't do that. I've started out on a mission, and I mustn't turn my back on it in cowardice. No, no, I couldn't go home at least I shouldn't want to go home." After a reflective pause, "Well, maybe, perhaps, it would be my duty to go in the circumstances. He's very old, and he does need me by him to stay his footsteps down the long hill that inclines westward toward the sunset of his life. Well, I'll think about that. Yes, of course it wouldn't be right to stay here. Perhaps I could just drop him a line and put it off a little while and satisfy him in that way. It would be, well, it would mar everything to have him require me to come instantly." Another reflective pause, then, "And yet, if he should do that, I don't know, but, oh, dear me, home, how good it sounds! And a body is excusable for wanting to see his home again, now and then, anyway." He went to one of the telegraph offices in the avenue and got the first end of what Barrow called the usual Washington courtesy, where "they treat you as a tramp until they find out you're a congressman, and then they slobber all over you." There was a boy of 17 on duty there, tying his shoe. He had his foot on a chair and his back turned toward the wicket. He glanced over his shoulder, took Tracy's measure, turned back, and went on tying his shoe. Tracy finished writing his telegram and waited, still waited, and still waited for that performance to finish. But there didn't seem to be any finish to it. So finally Tracy said, "Can't you take my telegram?" The youth looked over his shoulder and said by his manner, not his words, "Don't you think you could wait a minute if you tried?"